And a very warm welcome to you all. Whether you're here in person at St. Peter and St. Paul, or joining us at home through our YouTube channel, either live stream or later on in the week, welcome. My name is Clare, and me and my family are regular members here at this church, and it will be my pleasure this morning to lead us through today's service. We're a family church, and so we have our children and young people's groups running today as normal. That's up to age 14. And if you're new or visiting, you are very, very welcome to join us. But please, if this is your first session, please do accompany your child upstairs because we have a couple of forms to fill in. If you have babies or preschoolers, our creche is already running in the lower lounge. Ben is going to be preaching later on this morning as we continue our sermon series on Jonah, which we're looking at for the next 4 weeks, both here in the main church and in our children's groups as well. And now I have a very special helper who is going to give us a little reminder of what we looked at last week, because I appreciate not everybody could have been here. Now, when Ezra, this is my son, when he was younger, this was his favorite book, and we used to read it almost every night, and the story he would always choose is Jonah. And he used to know all the words off by heart, but it's been a little while since we read it, so he's going to read it for us this morning, just to bring you back up to speed.
Nineveh was a big city full of wicked people. God told Jonah to go to Nineveh and tell the people to mend their ways. But Jonah did not want to. He boarded a ship going the other way. That night, God sent a storm. Thunder roared and rumbled. Whirling waves bashed and smashed the little boat. "We're all going to drown," they said.
Said the terrified sailors.
"It's my fault," said Jonah. "Throw me overboard and the storm will stop." And over he went. Splash, he sank like a stone, down, down, deeper and deeper. Then suddenly a big fish swam up and swallowed him whole.
Thank you, Ezra. Now, let's turn our words and hearts to the Lord as we open our service in prayer. Dear Lord, we ask this morning that you will open our ears so that we may hear your voice. Open our minds so that we may receive your eternal wisdom. Open our spirits so that we may know your leading and guidance. And open our hearts so that we may receive your wonderful love. Amen. We're going to stand now together, if you're able to sing our first song, Oceans, which is rather fitting as we hear about Jonah's prayer today as he finds himself in the deepest place. Please do stand.
Waters, the great unknown. call upon your name. And keep my eyes above the waves, where oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace. For I am yours, and you are mine. Your praise abounds in deepest waters, your sovereign hand will be my guide. Where feet around me, you never failed, and you won't stop now. So I will call upon your name, and keep my eyes above the waves, where the oceans rise, my soul will rest in your trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters, wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters, wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. You will call upon your name. Keep my eyes above the waves, and watch my soul will rest in your embrace.
Thank you, and please do take a seat. We have so many great things happening in our parish, and it's all in the newsletter that Jane sends out every Friday. So please do, if you find that in your inbox, do read it. It will have all the information you need, but we do, of course, have hard copies available at the back of church for those who don't receive them in that way. There's a few that I'd like to highlight today, and all of our notices tie in with our vision for the church. So first of all, we have E in our vision, every word spoken for Jesus. And we have hope explored. Every pew has these in them. Please do take a look. Wednesday evenings, 24th and 31st of January and 7th of Feb. It's an exciting short 3-week course looking at the life, death and resurrection of Jesus in Luke's gospel. Exploring Christianity's claim to offer real hope, real peace and real purpose for life. Something we're all looking for. It's great for both Christians who want to refresh, and it's a great opportunity to invite friends and neighbours as well. So please do sign up via the website. D in our vision, deep pastoral care. So we have a book club. It was on the rolling notices at the start of church. Meets on a Monday. It's open for all the church family to attend, and they will be looking at Side by Side by Edward Welch. And it goes into a lot of detail about what deep pastoral care looks like. And it's a great read, and you're all invited to attend book club. T in vision, teaching and discipling with God's word. Put the parish Lent course in your diaries as soon as possible. Not right the second, maybe straight after the service if you haven't yet. We're coming across all of the churches together to look at this together. It's Shadows of the Cross, Easter through the Old Testament. Small group discussions and teaching from up the front. And that's Tuesday evenings on the 20th and 27th of Feb. and then the 5th and 19th of March. And we have G in vision, going out into the world. So hopefully you'll remember that there was a group that went out to Condoa at the end of last year. It was a really great trip. We've heard a little bit so far, but we've got a dedicated evening coming up where there'll be food, fellowship, and more feedback from that trip and inspiration about what's going on with our friends in Condoa. So if you're interested in that, please do book through the Church Suite, and that's on Saturday the 3rd of February. And a final reminder that everybody is welcome to join the Zoom prayer meetings on a Friday morning. It's just one of the many opportunities we have to pray together in the parish. More details of that, like everything else, is in the newsletter, so please do read. We come to confession time now. And I'm not sure if you remember, a few months ago when I was leading the service, I did a bit about like up and down and up and down and up and down, how confession worked in that way. We're going to come back to that again today. And in our story of Jonah, you might remember that God had told Jonah to go up to Nineveh to preach God's judgment against the wicked city. But instead of going up, he went down. He went away from God. He went down to Joppa. He went down to a ship. He went down in the ship to hide from God, and now he's in a fish going down even further. When you've hit the bottom, you've got no strength or hope, what's the one thing that is possibly left to do? It's pray. When we do anything that fails to honour God, we can only look one way, and that's up. We are called to repentance and faith today. Without Christ, we're at the bottom of the sea and lost, but with him, we have hope and eternal life. We're going to spend a few short moments thinking about those times this week where we haven't looked up to God, where we've gone down to get further away from him. Then we'll read through the confession together, reading the parts in bold together. The words will be on the screen. Lord God, our Maker and our Redeemer, this is your world and we are your people. Come among us and save us. We have willfully misused your gifts of creation. Lord, be merciful.
Forgive us our sins.
We have seen the ill treatment of others and have not gone to their aid. Lord, be merciful.
Forgive us our sins.
We have condoned evil and dishonesty and failed to strive for justice. Lord, be merciful.
Forgive us our sins.
We've heard the good news of Christ, but have failed to share it with others. Lord, be merciful.
Forgive us our sins.
We have not loved you with all our heart, nor our neighbours as ourselves. Lord, be merciful.
Forgive us our sins.
May Almighty God, who sent his Son into the world to save sinners, bring us his pardon and peace, now and forever. Amen. I'm going to invite Alison up now for Together Time.
Good morning. It's been lovely to have breakfast with some of our Sunday Club families this morning. And we have been thinking about what our children hear from the world around us. And it's just been an encouragement for me to think through about the better story that we have to offer. We have a God who loves us, who gives us identity. And over Christmas, looking back, we had lots of opportunities to celebrate the coming of our great God in his form of Jesus to walk amongst us. And a lot of us worked very hard to have these events over, well, I think they started in November, and they went on through December. And we're just going to have a moment now to think back over those wonderful things that we've been involved with. And the hundreds of people that have come through our doors of our churches to hear the greater story. So as we watch a little montage that Jane's kindly put together, do think about the friends and family that you've shared Christmas with, that you've shared this better story with, that you've shared the hope of Jesus on earth with, and family, friends, community, that have come through our doors over the last couple of months. Thank you for helping, but let's look at the little video to remind us of what's been going on, and then we'll pray. Great to look back and to celebrate what's gone on in the past. Let's pray. Lord God, we thank you for all the fun and celebrations we had over Christmas. Thank you for all the friends, the family, the community that came into our churches and shared and enjoyed the story of Jesus' birth. Thank you that we have such a great message of good news for all. Thank you that you have rescued even us. Please would you help us to continue to speak of that message of hope with our friends, with our family, with our community. And would you, through your Holy Spirit, open hearts to your truth. And may those hearts bear fruit. May they come into relationship with the Saviour Jesus Christ. And may we grow in our knowledge and understanding of your love and compassion and mercy as we continue to worship you today. Please help our leaders, especially upstairs this morning, as the children too continue to learn from Jonah. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. In a moment, the children will go upstairs, young people, but we're going to stand to sing two songs, and the children will go up out after the first song. So we're going to sing, focusing on our great rescuer, that message of rescue that we have to share with our community. Please stand and join us to sing.
There is good news for the captive. Good news for the shamed. There is good news for the one who walked away. There is good news for the doubter, the one religion failed. For the Lord has come to seek and save. He's our rescuer. He's our rescuer. We are free from sin forevermore. Oh, sweet the sound.
He's our rescuer. We are free from sin.
land, the sea, your grace is deep as here. Who, O Lord, could save themselves, their own soul could heal? Our shame was deeper than the sea, your grace is deep as here. We rescue you along and save you along and live.
Please do take a seat. Adam's going to bring us our reading now, and then Ben will lead us in the word from God.
This morning's reading is taken from Jonah chapter 2, and you'll find the start of that reading on page 927. Of the church Bibles, it will also be on the screen. So it's Jonah chapter 2. From inside the fish, Jonah prayed to the Lord his God. He said, "In my distress, I called to the Lord, and he answered me. From the depths of the grave, I called for help. And you listened to my cry. You hurled me into the deep, into the very heart of the seas, and the currents swirled about me. All your waves and breakers swept over me. I said, 'I have been banished from your sight, yet I will look again towards your holy temple.' The engulfing waters threatened me. The deep surrounded me. Seaweed was wrapped around my head. To the roots of the mountains I sank down. The earth beneath barred me in forever. But you brought my life up from the pit, O Lord, my God. When my life was ebbing away, I remembered you, Lord, and my prayer rose to you, to your holy temple. Those who cling to worthless idols forfeit the grace that could be theirs. But I, with a song of thanksgiving, will sacrifice to you. What I have vowed, I will make good. Salvation comes from the Lord. And the Lord commanded the fish, and it vomited Jonah onto dry land. This is the word of the Lord.
Our second reading can be found on page 1174. It's from Ephesians chapter 2. As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins, in which you used to live, when you followed the ways of this world and the ruler of the kingdom of the air, the spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. All of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our sinful nature and following its desires and thoughts. Like the rest, we were by nature objects of wrath. But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Sarah, Adam. Do keep your Bibles open at page 927. We're going to be focusing on Jonah this morning. Let me pray for us before we have a look at these verses. Father God, thank you for your word to us. Father God, we really do pray that we might sit under it today. I pray that your spirit might inspire us to live as your people in ways that bring you honour and glory. Give us a delight in your word this morning, a delight to be your people, for the glory of your name. Amen. You may well have heard the expression, the elephant in the room. It refers to a big issue nobody's mentioning, but everybody is aware of. The massive elephant in the room this morning isn't actually a massive elephant, but a massive fish. The plausibility of what we've just read. Of Jonah's miraculous survival. Can we really believe this actually happened? Some people just can't take it seriously. That they try to explain it away. It can't possibly actually have happened. It must be a metaphor for something spiritual, they say. Or some even stranger explanations. The best one I've heard is that the fish is the name of the inn Jonah stayed in to recover after his ordeal at sea. That is not really good enough. It is poor handling of the biblical text. That sort of problem isn't unique to the narrative of Jonah, though. The Bible contains many astonishing miracles. Jesus did many of them. What do we do with that? The first thing we might do is just write them off because we believe miracles don't happen. The problem is with that is that we start with a conclusion. Miracles don't happen. So we can never deal with evidence to the contrary. Even if a miracle happened right before our eyes, we would say no, because miracles don't happen. Well, the second thing we might do is consider more what the Bible says. That God has a normal way by which he sustains his creation, that the way things normally happen. And that means we can observe our creation scientifically. We can explore the evidence. But because we recognize God made and sustains creation, we accept that the Creator God is perfectly able to break those normal natural rules himself for any good reason he chooses, whether that's turning water into wine or perhaps in sending a big fish to rescue a stubborn, disobedient prophet. God's in charge of it all. We've already seen that in Jonah chapter 1, as God controls the storm and God controls the drawing of the lots which land on Jonah. With a God that big, now the miracle of Jonah and the big fish is actually small fry. And so we land ourselves in Jonah chapter 1. God's prophet, given a special message to speak God's words, but he doesn't want to, so he runs away. away from God? So committed is Jonah to his disobedience, he'd rather face death than obey God. And to cut a long story short, there's an unsurprising consequence to Jonah's disobedience. He comes under God's judgment, thrown by the sailors into a watery grave, to the bottom of the sea. And yet Jonah chapter 2, all is not lost. Have you ever had that experience of your life flashing before your eyes? I did once as a teacher on a school ski trip. I remember vividly hurtling towards the edge of a cliff and trying to stop. I thought, this is the end of my life. This is how it all ends on a school ski trip in France. Or somehow I hurled myself to the ground before the big drop. And after the shock wore off, the joy to be alive was palpable. I'd been rescued from death. It could have been so different. Yet I had the joy of another moment, another breath. This is how Jonah is feeling in chapter 1. He is hurtling to the edge of a cliff or to the bottom of the ocean and thinking, this is it. But then, an extraordinary rescue. Chapter 2 this morning is a psalm. It is a song of rescue. It is a turning point in the narrative. Up to now, Clare did it brilliantly earlier. Jonah has been running away and going down. Now he's on his way up and back to God. And this prayerful song expands on just how God has rescued Jonah. It's a song all about God. Chapter 1, verse 17, God provides the fish. And God is the object of Jonah's prayer and thanksgiving inside the fish. Jonah was swallowed up by death, yet provides a rescue. So two things for us this morning. Two things this story of thanksgiving teaches us. As Jonah prays from inside the fish, we learn about Jonah's perilous predicament. Then secondly, God's gracious rescue. First, on the screens, Jonah's perilous predicament. As Jonah is thrown overboard, chapter 1, by the sailors into the raging ocean storm, we read here, chapter 2, verse 2, of his distress. Jonah is drowning. In the depths of the grave, the bottom of the ocean, Jonah knows he's going to die. Staring death in the face, verse 3, the current swirling about him, waves and breakers sweep over him, down, 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 engulfed. Verse 5, seaweed wrapping round his body to the very roots of the ground, down, 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 onto the ocean floor, perhaps moments left. Verse 7, Jonah's life is ebbing away. And yet we also see here how Jonah's predicament is even worse than that. Jonah hasn't accidentally fallen overboard. Verse 3, Jonah recognizes it's God who acted in sending him, or so he thought, to a watery grave. It's God's, it's your breakers, your waves and breakers that swept over him. God is in charge, God is in control of everything. This is not random peril, but God's work. The reason for Jonah's predicament is because God's hand is against him. Jonah tried to cut himself off from God's presence in chapter 1, to live as if he was in charge of his life, and now he fears he's got what he wanted. Jonah's perilous predicament. It is a stark picture of the natural predicament facing all of us. We heard that in our second reading. As Paul writes to the Christians in the city of Ephesus, chapter 2, verse 1, he says, as for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins. It is the natural state of us all. Put a bit more starkly, we tend to think that before being Christians, we were just a bit lost. We were just lacking a bit of direction. Not totally fulfilled, a bit off the path, but doing okay. Paul's diagnosis is much more serious. We were dead in our transgressions and sins. Death has taken us spiritually. Death will take us physically one day. We can't escape that. Down in the depths, it's really serious. In fact, verse 3, Paul goes on to tell us God's hand was against us. As those who naturally want to live in charge of our lives, or I guess all of us do really, certainly I do, Paul reminds us, gratifying the cravings of our sinful nature and following its desires and thoughts, we were by nature objects of wrath, of God's wrath. Our predicament before we became Christians is really serious, because the Bible tells us God is angry at our sin, our wanting to be in charge of our lives rather than God, of our running away from God in doing that. That's why sin matters so much, because of the consequences. It provokes God's right anger. That's the thing we need rescuing from, the prospect of being cut off from God's love forever. You may be listening now and thinking this is all a bit heavy, especially if you aren't yet a Christian here. But I want to say that fundamentally, Christianity is good news. It is great news. It is a message of God's great rescue. We will come to that in a moment. But what makes it such great news is how much we are all, each, in need of his rescue. And how, like Jonah in the depths, we cannot rescue ourselves. When we realize the depths of our problem before God, that's when his rescue is even more wonderful to us. Jonah gets that. Jonah's as good as dead at the bottom of the ocean, Jonah's perilous predicament. So Jonah does the only thing he can do. He has no claim on God. He has no right to God. He's run away from God. And now it seems God's given him what he wanted. All Jonah can do is cry out to God, accepting his fate, committing himself into God's hands. From the depths of the raging sea, Jonah cries out to God. And God answers. God answers Jonah's prayer. Jonah is as good as dead, was as good as dead before God graciously, undeservingly answers Jonah's prayer to him. God does a miracle. And that brings us to the second thing from the passage this morning, God's gracious rescue. Jonah accepts his guilt, he accepts his punishment, and he cries out to God, who accepts Jonah's prayer. Verse 2, in my distress, I called to the Lord and he answered me. From the depths of the grave, I called for help and you listened to my cry. Verse 6, you brought my life up from the pit. God accepts Jonah's prayer and provides a rescue, a gracious, undeserving rescue in the form of a great fish who swallows Jonah. From where he now prays, God does a miracle. And Jonah is brought up from his virtual grave by God. This runaway, this prodigal, is returning to God. God's rescuing love, gracious, undeserving, it is winning. God's promises ring true to Jonah and to us. God is a rescuing God. Jonah knows what God is like, as does the writer to the Hebrews, chapter 4, verse 16, encouraging us as those trusting in Jesus to then approach God's throne of grace with confidence so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help us in our time of need. This psalm in Jonah chapter 2 is written in such a way Jonah well understands God's grace. As one writer notes, Jonah knows he's been given life instead of the death he deserves. God answers sinners' prayers. The prayers of the broken and messy and messed up who cry to him for help and forgiveness. Fundamentally, Christianity is good news. It is great news. When we realize who we are and who God really is. that the Creator God of the universe cares enough, loves enough, is interested enough to hear the prayer of a broken sinner like Jonah, like me, like you. Can it really be? Imagine writing a letter to King Charles. We don't really expect a reply. It'd be lovely if some sort of junior palace official gave us an acknowledgement at least, but we don't even expect that. But imagine then on Christmas Day, watching the king's speech, you see Charles pull out your letter from his pocket. Amazing. How amazing that the God of the universe should hear and answer the prayer of a sinking prophet. God hears our prayers, and that is good news for Jonah, and it is good news for me, and it is good news for you, all because ultimately Jesus went down to the depths of the grave and rose again, that God might hear our prayers as we trust in him. We don't need to prove ourselves before God hears our prayers. We don't need to get ourselves sorted before we can come to God. Jesus has done everything we need to come to God through his death and resurrection. God just wants us to turn to him. Whoever we are, whatever we've done, whatever state we come to him in, God just wants us to cry out to him in humble dependence. And we can do so because of Jesus. That is the really great news of Christianity. If you know you've been running away from God or simply ignoring him, turn to him and ask him for help. He will help us because of Jesus. And so we go back to our second reading, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 3. As we turn to God in humble dependence, recognizing we have nothing and he's done everything we need, saying sorry for running away from a God who loves us more than we love ourselves, Paul says to us, we were by nature objects of God's wrath, but he goes on in verse 4, but because of his great love for us, in fact, the language is even more exciting than that. The words better read, because of the great love with which he has loved us. God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in our transgressions, our sin. It is by grace you have been saved. It is God's gracious rescue. A rescue that comes to Jonah through Jesus, not because of anything Jonah had done. A rescue that comes to us through Jesus, not because of anything we do. The heart of the great news of Christianity is summed up in a single verse. John's Gospel, chapter 3, verse 16, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. God rescues hopeless cases, like Jonah, like us, by grace, undeserved. This is what God's in the business of doing. For all who will come to him asking for his rescue, it is God's gracious rescue. God brings dead people back to life. Jonah, miraculously from his virtual grave. Jesus also did it literally with Lazarus, for example. They are all signs of what God does spiritually inside for all who will come to him asking for rescue. So do not cling, as Jonah recognizes in verse 8, to worthless idols. Gods of our lives that really are no gods at all. They cannot save us. Our gods of education or work or our family or school, how we look like in real life or on social media, they cannot save us. When we cling to worthless idols, Jonah tells us we forfeit the grace that could be ours. There is only one God who can rescue sinners. Jonah knows it. Verse 9, salvation comes from the Lord. Jesus declares it too. John 14, 6, Jesus says of himself, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. There is one God, one hope, one Lord and Saviour. This one God of the Bible tells us he alone can rescue sinners, like Jonah, like me, like you. Jonah's perilous predicament, God's gracious rescue. As we finish now, Jonah learned that the hard way, that he couldn't run away from God. In fact, even if he could have done, in the end he realised it wasn't what he wanted. It certainly wasn't what was best for him. Jonah was, in the words of one writer, wise enough to run back to God and ask for forgiveness. And when we do that, we can't help do anything other than praise God for his gracious rescue. If you have received that offer of rescue, praise God here this morning. Be strengthened as you trust in him, as you realise what he's done for you. If you haven't yet received that offer of rescue, praise God that it is still there for you. Whoever you are, whatever you've done, however you come to him this morning. And let me encourage you to indeed do as Jonah did, to come to God in humble dependence, recognizing we have nothing and he has everything we need, saying sorry for running away from a God who loves us more than we love ourselves, and knowing his rescue because of Jesus. Why don't we bring those things to God now in a moment of prayer? Father God, we thank you for your word to us, which reminds us how great you are, the rescuing God. It reminds us of our perilous predicament and of our need for you. Help us turn to you, to trust you, and entrust our whole lives to you. In Jesus' name we pray now. Amen.
Thank you, Ben. We come now to another time of worship to send those praises back to God for what we've heard this morning. Even though Jonah did his best to flee from God, God was never less than faithful to Jonah and the people of Nineveh, whom he also loved. We're going to sing now, "Great Your Faithfulness," as we remember that even when we lose faith in ourselves or faith in God, he never stops being faithful to us. If you're able, please do stand for "Great Your Faithfulness."
Great Your Faithfulness, O God, my Father, O God, my Father. Love it never fades, and so I love you unto the end. When shadows fall, you never change. From age to age, you never change. Great is your faithfulness. Always been there. Great is your love for us, your love for us. Through the years you've always been there. Great your kindness, God. You are our shelter, our dwelling place, present like a hope for tomorrow, strength for today. When shadows fall, you never change. From age to age, you never change. Great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. Through the years you've always been there. Great is your love for us. Love for us.
Stay standing as we come to the Creed. The Apostles' Creed is a summary of what the Church teaches and of what Christians together believe, rather than a detailed statement of personal and individual belief. Saying the Creed binds us together as Christians, as a believing community, across the different traditions and practices. If you want to join now in this collective declaration of our faith, please do so. If not, if you're not in that place, then you might want to simply reflect on the words that others are saying. The words will be on the screen and we will read them together. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
David is going to bring us our prayers now. Please do take a seat.
Well, we've been thinking about Jonah in that whale and his prayer and need. And we pray for God to help us in our weakness. And when I say, Lord, we turn to you, will you say, hear us and help us? Lord, we turn to you.
Hear us and help us.
Blessed are you, Lord God, for you have called us out of darkness into your glorious light. You seek out and save all who are lost and willing to turn to you. You are our God and Saviour. Blessed are you, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And Lord, we thank you for those who made us welcome within the church, within this church. May we always be open to all who are seeking and turning away from their sin. Help us to be a welcoming church, open to all. We ask for your blessing on all who are clergy, readers, pastoral assistants, all who have gone under training formally, and all who teach and care for your people in this place. We pray for all who are involved in the ministry of reconciliation and healing. We pray for a willingness for many of us to be involved in prayer ministry and pastoral care as we support one another to join those courses and those things that we're training towards. So, Lord, we turn to you.
Hear us and help us.
We pray for all who've been led astray, all who are caught up in crime, violence, or addiction. we remember all who do not know you or love you. We ask you to guide and strengthen all who work for the good of others, for those giving advice in things like debt counselling, abuse, Alcoholics Anonymous, all who seek to bring peace to our world. 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 and 2 reminds us, pray especially for rulers and their governments to rule well, so we can be quietly about our business of living simply in humble contemplation. This is the way our Saviour God wants us to live. So we do pray for our government and Prime Minister, for wisdom in so many difficult decisions. We pray for the leaders, particularly of the major powers like America, Russia, and China, that they may choose for peace and reconciliation rather than war and discord, to look beyond themselves, to see their need of your wisdom, Lord. Lord, we turn to you, hear us and help us. We give thanks for those who've taught us the good news, for those who've shared their faith with us. We pray for bishops and clergy to seek your truth and understanding as they lead your church through unsettling times. Lord, help us to turn to you each day and to be faithful to you. We ask your blessing upon all who are suffering from broken relationships, broken homes. Particularly, we think of children and young people. I'm reading in the paper yesterday, the challenge is great. Last year, there were 136,000 young people registered to be homeless. We pray that they may find stability and reassurance. We pray for our families and friends who are also in need. Lord, we turn to you. Hear us and help us. And Lord God, we are aware of many who feel a great challenge at this time. We remember all who feel lost, and those for whom life seems to have no purpose. We remember all who feel they failed in life and all who despair at this time. May they know your great love for them, your saving power. We pray for those who are suffering or in hospital, at home or in hospital. And we pray for those who are caring for them. Lord, we turn to you, hear us and help us. So let's pray the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you, David. It's time for our final hymn now, and we're going to acknowledge God's mercy and amazing love in this hymn, O God Beyond All Praising. If you are able, please do stand.
worship you today and sing the love amazing that songs cannot relay. For we can only wonder at every gift you send, at blessings without number and mercies without end. We lift our hearts before you and wait upon your word. We honor and adore you, O great and mighty Lord. Then hear, O gracious Saviour, accept the love we bring, that we who know your favour may serve you as the King. And whether our tomorrows be filled with good or ill, we are triumphant through our sorrows and rise to bless you still, to marvel at your beauty and glory in your ways, and make a joyful duty of sacrifice for
praise. Please do take a seat. As we come to the end of our service now, let me remind you that if you wish as members of the congregation to make an offering, giving financially to the work of God in this church, the parish and the wider world, you are very welcome to do so. At the back we have a plate and card readers. If you have children in SOS, Sunday Club, or creche, please do co-collect them in a second. And then afterwards, please do stay for tea, coffee, and refreshments in the coffee lounge. It's a great time to catch up with friends, or even better, talk to somebody who you don't know or you've not seen for a very long time. If you're new or visiting, please do make yourself known to myself or to Ben, or anyone with a badge, or anyone that looks as though they've been here for a while and know the place. Before we head off, let me share a closing prayer using part of Jonah's. He said, "Those who cling to worthless idols turn away from God's love for them. But I, with shouts of grateful praise, will sacrifice to you. What I have vowed, I will make good. I will say salvation comes from the Lord." Lord, as we enter a new week, help us to turn from false idols and keep our eyes and hearts fixed on you. Help us to praise you always as we remember salvation comes from you. Now may the blessing of God the Father, who made from one every nation that occupies the earth, of God the Son, who brought us for God from every tribe and language and people and nation, and of God the Spirit, who brings us together in unity, be with us and remain with us always. Amen.